system x dot t equal to x t, then they define something called a transition matrix. Here in this particular case it will be like this, which is e to the power a t minus t naught, okay, that I think Mick already talked about. And it is very important definition. You already know about stability of a matrix, which Mick already defined. Now a system is said to be in steady state when the state is constant, that x t is independent of time, it is a constant vector. And the solution in general for this is already discussed by Mika, so which is this. Now when you say this system controllable, okay, so if for any time t 1 which is bigger than t naught, so this is the initial time, for any x naught and x 1, so this x naught is nothing but the state vector at time t 0 and x 1 is the state vector at time t 1. So there exists an input u t such that the system is taken from the initial state x naught to the final state x 1. You give me, so suppose the initial state is x naught, that is just a vector, and you give me any vector which is x t 1, the final state, you want your system to be in that desired state. Then I will say that the system is controllable if I can design an input u t which will do that job, okay. Then the system is controllable, and there is a condition, because the system depends on the four matrices A, B, C, D. So basically the state dynamics is given by the first equation, which is given by the matrices A and B. So depending on A and B, there is a condition under which a system is controllable. You can decide that, which is given by this controllability matrix, which is also called a Kalman matrix. So this is C, A, B. So first, this is a block matrix. This is B, this is A, B, A square B, A to the power minus 1 B. And we say the system is controllable if it has full row rank, it's at rank n, let's say, okay. Suppose you are starting with a b c d of order n by n. So if it's full row rank, then we say that matrix is the system is controllable, okay. And it is equivalent to saying that this controllability Gramianian, this is positive definite, okay. So you may just see the proof later on. Yeah, now I'll talk about how this Ricard equation appears, okay. So this is little bit of, yes, now the thing is, so the main concern is to have a control over the system of that particular form, standard form. Now control will allow the system to converge towards the desired state, which you already said. A control is handled through a feedback input which depends upon the state of the system. We wish to choose an input, this is very, very important. This is how, where optimal control comes into the picture. We wish to choose an input, that ut, to derive the state of the system towards 0 while also limiting the size of the input ut. So there is a constraint now on ut. And more precisely, actually want to minimize this function j, where this q is a positive semi-definite matrix and it represents the cost penalty attributed to the state. This matrix R is a positive definite and it matrix and it represents the cost penalty attributed to the input. And this matrix Z1 is a positive definite matrix which represents the cost penalty attributed to the final state. So you want to design your input in such a way that this function is optimized, okay. So have a minimal cost in some sense. So if you understand, it's fine. So now we can write, of course, if B is lineal, so B has linear independent columns, then of course you can write input as this. So you are introducing a new vector PT, and if you keep on doing it, so there's some little bit of algebraic manipulation which is meaningful in the terms of physical process. So ultimately this will attain minimum if this delta is very important here, because it's a perturbation to the input, that PT P plus delta some PP hat T. So anyway, so we'll get this one, this function, and you have to this will be minimum, that J, if the derivative of this function with respect to delta is 0. So ultimately you do the derivative and do go on doing this, so ultimately you end up getting this equation. So everything is clearly mentioned here, you don't have to get stuck anywhere, everything is logical, meaningful. So ultimately you end up getting this. Now see, this is a differential equation, first order, d of pt, this pt is a matrix, dt is equal to minus q minus a transpose pt minus pt a plus pt s pt. So this is just a Ricard equation, it is actually called a differential Ricard equation. And if you are interested in steady state solution, then P is constant. So this will be 0. So you just have the Rickert equation. Okay. And how is it related to the performance of the system or controllability of the system? The optimal choice of the input that minimizes the infinite horizon cost function, this is given by the input this, and here you need to have the value of P infinity, which is a solution of the algebraic Rickert equation given this way. Okay. So if you want to optimize your cost for the controllability of the system, and that input is given by this particular expression, where there is a variable P infinity, because you know R, it is related to the cost function, you know B, which is already given to you. This unknown P infinity is a solution of an algebraic Rickert equation. Okay. So this is a fundamental problem in control theory, how to solve this kind of matrix equation, which is known as algebraic Rickert equation. But here you can see that this A is exactly equal to A transpose here. Okay. So what I had shown to you, there is no A transpose. So D need not be equal to A transpose. So that's a general algebraic Rickert equation now. And here you have a very particular case where A transpose and this is A. So D equal to A transpose here. Okay. And now we'll talk about first this general version of the algebraic Rickert equation. And it has a lot of uses. And let me confess that this is not an easy problem. Okay, given any A, B, C, D matrices, you want to find out a matrix X which will satisfy this equation. It's not an easy task. And if you go to MathSciNet, the page or page maintained by the database maintained by the American Mathematical Society, if you just write algebraic Rickert equation, till today there are 502 articles whose title includes the phrase algebraic Rickert equation. So many people attempted to solve this problem for different particular cases. Let's say A is of this particular form, D is of this particular form, and so on. In general, solving this problem is difficult. Okay, and if you include the electrical engineering literature, then it will definitely cross 1000. Okay, so there are a lot of articles, papers, books, okay, which talk about solving algebraic Rickert equation. Okay, now here what I'll do is, I'll talk about a very special case, okay, where you can solve this algebraic Rickert equation with a minimal knowledge of linear algebra, and that is invariant subspace. Okay, if you have a little bit of knowledge of invariant subspace, then you can solve this problem for some particular case. Okay, and if you are interested to know more about it, you have to read the books and the papers. Okay. Okay. Now the first thing is, If you consider this A, B, C, D as just the numbers, then you get a quadratic polynomial. So you may think that this is nothing but a generalization of a quadratic polynomial, right? But then the question is, why do we call it Rickert algebraic equation? You can just say this is the matrix quadratic polynomial or generalized version of the quadratic polynomial equation. But the question is, why do we call it a Rickert, an algebraic Rickert equation, for example? So for that, I need to know who is Rickert, by the way, okay, and how his name is associated with this equation. So now I'll talk a little bit about Rickert. So his full name is Count Jacopo Rickert, was born in Venice, Italy, in 1676. May 28, and his father died when he was only 10 years old. So he was basically raised by his mother, who got never married after that. And one of his uncles understood his ability and got him an admission in some college. And after that, he enrolled in University of Padua as a student of law. Okay, so that was in 1693, and there was a professor, Stefano, who was giving lectures on astronomy, and Rickert was attending some of his lectures, and then Stefano also found him very interesting student. So Stefano gave him this book. So this book is Philosophy, whatever it is. So in English it means mathematical principle of natural philosophy. Okay, and this is a collection of work of Isaac Newton. So he passed on this book to this Riccardi. Anyway, he started reading it probably, and in 1696 he got married, and he had 18 children, of whom 9 only survived childhood. Okay, he was a man who never have gone outside his home. In his entire life, only 3 months he had spent outside his home due to his illness. So he preferred better to stay at home than university or anything else. Okay, and he did not follow any lecture courses in mathematics. Basically, the profound knowledge of the self-taught man was acquired by reading. So he never had any formal course in mathematics, and he had far-reaching interests ranging from mathematics to poetry, physics to religion, as witnessed by his works and his rich library. He also believed that the brain should be better exercised in a variety of fields, as he wrote, since adolescence, it means when you become an adult. The mind should be educated to treasure the most eminent of sciences and the finest of arts. And he said, I do not want to claim that every topic should be probed in detail. Following one's own talent and inclination, one should select at least one topic and study it in depth. In the others, one should follow the example of the bee which sucks a drop of nectar from each flower. Okay, so if your background is computer science, don't worry. You are learning something in control, it's fine. So do better in computer science, also learn this control. Maybe you can apply some control theory stuff in computer science. Not a big deal. And he turned many Nobel invitations, including the most appealing one of becoming president of St. Petersburg Academy. He also refused the chair of mathematics at University of Padua and the invitation of the Court of Wien as Audley advisor, because he was also a lawyer. Okay, by education he studied law. And on April 2nd, 1754, he had a sudden bout of fever a fortnight later. So that time fever could be critical. So a fortnight later, on April 15th, he passed away. Okay, now how this equations got this name? So Riccardi's interest evolved around the scalar equations of the type x dot equal to x square plus bx plus c. So x depends on time, and these coefficients a, b, and c, they could also depend on the time. Okay, so he was interested to solve this kind of a differential equation. And besides a number of other further equations of first order, he was also interested in this kind of equation where x dot equal to alpha t to the power p x to the power q plus beta t to the power m. He was looking for some solution of this kind of a differential equation. He was particularly attracted by the equation x double dot, the double derivative of x equal to alpha t to the power m, t is the independent variable here, which he called misleading equation. And a generalization of the equation into a matrix form is the matrix Riccardi equation, plays a major role in many designing problems, especially control. Okay, so this is how this equation got the name Riccardi equation, you can see from here. So it is just a generalization of the quadratic polynomial, but it came from this differential equation. So people call it Riccardi equation, or algebraic or differential Riccardi equation. Okay, good. So far so good. Now, from the basic understanding that if you want to solve this kind of a polynomial, which is just a quadratic polynomial, okay, so you have to solve this. Definitely, you know the solution, right? And solution depends on this coefficients a, b, c. So the guess is, whatever be the solution here for this algebraic equation, that x must depend on the coefficients a, b, c, d. Okay, that's the first observation. So the procedure is, if you construct this matrix, this H, which is like this. Now you can see, so okay, the dimension of A is like n by n, you know the dimension here, okay, the compatible dimension. So this is of order m plus n times m plus n. Okay. Now this matrix, which is a block matrix, 2 by 2 block matrix, which has a very peculiar relation, an interesting relation, and the main relation with the solution x. And what it is? So it is the following. So X satisfies this equation if and only if H times this I n x is equal to I n x times A minus P x. See, here you do not know what x is, okay, but what you know is if x is a solution, it must satisfy this equation. And how is it? So if you just write A minus B minus C D and multiply it with I n x, so what do you get? You get this A minus B x, now minus C minus D x. Now from here, from the algebraic equation, this equation, okay. So what do you know about C plus D x? This is now nothing but A minus B x times x A minus x B x, okay. So this is now I n x A minus B x, okay. Now from the dimension, you just see that this matrix is an n cross n matrix, okay. Now what does give you? It gives you the fact that now this is the matrix whose columns are independent, linearly independent, because we have the identity matrix here. So this matrix, the column space of this matrix will be of dimension n, and this space is an invariant subspace of this matrix, because we have this sum matrix here which is not known because x is not known. So if you want to solve this algebraic cut equation, you first construct this matrix H, which is actually called a linearizing matrix, because you started with a nonlinear problem, now you end up with a linear problem or linear algebra problem. And what is that? You have to compute basis of an invariant subspace. So suppose you have anything like this, which is an invariant subspace, and its basis is of this form I n x, then that's a solution. If you know x, then that's a solution. So what the problem is now, you are given with a matrix, you know what H is, you know what H is, okay. This H you already know because A, B, C, D are known to you. Now you want to compute its invariant subspace such that the invariant subspace must have a basis of this particular form. So once you compute that basis, you know what x is, and that solves the problem. You understand this? So it reduces to a linear algebra problem only to compute invariant subspace of a matrix which is a 2 by 2 block matrix. It is simple, as simple as that, okay. Now this is okay, this space like here, the space which is spanned by this I n x, as Mika told you last day, is called a graph space. I think that this graph space was first named by Professor Peter Lancaster in his book on algebraic cut equation, that is called a graph space. Okay, the second observation, this is also very interesting. What it says is, if lambda is an eigenvalue of this, so I'll write this capital lambda as a set of all eigenvalues, or the multiset of eigenvalues of this matrix, then it implies lambda is also an eigenvalue of H. How? Okay, let us assume that lambda is an eigenvalue of this. So it means there must exist a non-zero vector y for which this will be equal to lambda y. Right? What I need to show, that this lambda is also an eigenvector, eigenvalue of this H. Now you know that H satisfies this one, okay, if it has the solution x. Okay. Now what you do with the simple thing is you multiply y both side. So this is what then? This is I n x, and this is just lambda y. Okay. So it implies what? H y x y is equal to lambda y x y. And now the interesting part here, you see, you know the matrix H. So you know the all the, assume that you know all the eigenvalues of H, you can compute them. So you do not know what x is, but you know that eigenvalues of H which are actually related to the eigenvalues of A minus Bx, because the eigenvalues of A minus Bx is exactly an eigenvalue. Any eigenvalue of A minus Bx is an eigenvalue of H. So you know the eigenvalues of H or A minus Bx, but you do not know what X is. Okay? So this is becoming now a mystery. And the third observation, this is also very interesting. So for the third observation, so what we say is that the spectra of H, the eigenvalues of H, the linearizing matrix H, is nothing but the union of eigenvalues of A minus Bx and minus D plus XB. So you know all the eigenvalues, which are just the union of eigenvalues of these two matrices, and you do not know what X is. But you know the eigenvalues of this matrix and the eigenvalues of matrix. Okay, how this is true? So for that, what you do is you multiply H by this matrix. Okay, which is what? Which is you have A minus B minus C minus D, if I remember it correctly, then you have I n 0 x I m, which is then A minus B x, then what is this minus B, here it is minus C minus D x, and here it is minus D, right? So far so good, but this also can be written as this. Why is that? Multiply this into this, you got A minus Bx, or this into this, you got minus B. Now this into this is what? X A minus X times Bx, but X satisfies the algebraic equation, so it is actually minus D minus Dx, and this times this, which is again minus XB, and here it is XB minus D, so XB XB got cancelled, you have only minus D, minus D. So and this is an invertible matrix. And this is the same matrix what you have here. So what you have ultimately? So it implies I n 0 x I n inverse H times I n 0 x I m, okay, is equal to this. And this is a very important observation which I will use later. Okay, this is a very, very important observation. So what it means is, so this is a matrix which is similar to H. So the eigenvalues of H are the same as the eigenvalues of this, which is exactly equal to this. This is a block triangular matrix, upper triangular matrix. So the eigenvalues will be this union the eigenvalues of this. And so this is a very nice inverse eigenvalue problem in order to solve algebraic equation. So if you are a PhD student, how?
Because if we change the x,
okay,
the eigenvalue of h will be fixed.
Okay.
H is the fixed.
Okay. Using this argument, I'll show you that this is not one. Little later. Okay. Okay. So as I said, this is very nice observation that suppose you know the eigenvalues of A minus Bx, because you know the eigenvalues of H, and some of them are the eigenvalues of A minus Bx, and rest are eigenvalues of x minus D, and eigenvalues of A minus Bx definitely. If there is a unique x, then that x is the solution, but there could be multiple x's for which eigenvalues of A minus B x is the same, then the problem comes, it is not unique. Okay, so if you are a linear algebra student doing MSc or PhD, so this is a very interesting problem, which is inverse eigenvalue problem. So you know the eigenvalues of A minus B x, you know the eigenvalues of XB minus D or minus D plus XB. So you know that eigenvalues of this matrix as well as my difference of find X. So this is an inverse eigenvalue problem. Okay, you have to find out all possible such matrices X for which the given set of eigenvalues is actually the set of eigenvalues for these two matrices. Okay, so this is a nice problem for your PhD regarding algebraic equation. Okay, so next, so as I already told you, the finding a solution of the algebraic equation is equivalent to finding the basis of an invariant subspace of H, By the way, so basis need not come in that particular form, that I, n and x. It may just come. So suppose you are starting with H, you want to find out an invariant subspace, that means it satisfies this. You found a basis of V, n dimensional basis of V, invariant subspace. You can just write this. So here it is n by n and this is the rest. Okay. Now, this is the basis. Now, if this y is invertible, okay, so then what you can do, if suppose this is the basis, so you can write then this as this, some let us say gamma matrix or some P matrix, okay, because this is an invariant subspace, basis of an invariant subspace. So, there must be one matrix here, okay, that is obvious. So, now what you do is, you want to have one here, identity here, you write identity, does not matter. Then you have to take your y here, right. So, then you have to multiply here y inverse, okay, and this equals to then this y is here, but you do not want to have this y, you just have identity here, this is z. So, you have y inverse, you have y and this is p, but y is invertible. So, you can take that y here, does not matter. So, ultimately you have this. Now, you see this matrix also has the same eigenvalues as P, but this is a different matrix, you understand, okay, it is a different matrix and this is a solution. So, any basis you give me does not matter of an invariant subspace, but this n by n matrix is invertible, you get a solution, okay, is that fair enough, okay. Now, the next interesting thing is a connection between the. Actually, this is the most interesting thing that the solution x is related to the eigenvectors of a minus b x. Okay. So, what I told you is the following, that you have this, if x is a solution, then it must satisfy this. So, after all this is a matrix whose dimension is n. So, this is square matrix, n by n matrix, okay. Okay, which you can make sure from this a, b, c, d, okay, which are in which dimension. Okay. So, B is n cross m and x is m cross n. So, ultimately you get what, n cross n, and A is already n cross n. So, it is n cross n matrix. Okay. So, since you have a matrix, square matrix, you can talk about its Jordan canonical form, which Mika already talked to you. So, you can write this matrix A minus B x as some y j y inverse. Okay, you can have the Jordan block. So, if you have any matrix here, forget about x, you do not know x. Whatever matrix is here, for that you have a Jordan canonical form. If you put it here, then what do you get? H I n x is equal to I n x y j y inverse. What it does then? H times this, if you multiply y both sides, so you have y x y, okay, equal to y x y j. And now, what is this y? See, this y is invertible and this is nothing but the set of Jordan chains of this matrix. So, somehow if you know some matrix here, you know the Jordan chains of that, you put it here and then x times y, that will give you the solution. So, basically this is very important thing, that this is made of Jordan chains. So, if you want to construct a basis, okay, for an invariant subspace, okay. So, what you do is, suppose you know this, if you know x, then you can have this Jordan canonical form and this basis will appear here, okay. So, this is the connection between the Jordan canonical form and this, you understand, okay, but of course, I do not know what x is. So, this is an example where we can see that for the same set of eigenvalues, we may have different solutions. Okay. So, it is not even, it is not a 1-1 correspondence. So, let us say A is equal to this matrix 3, 0, 2, 3, B is this one, C is this one, D is this one, has solution this. How do we check that is a solution? Construct H, then multiply that with I x, you know x, what it is, Then in the right hand side you have Ix, the column, that block matrix, times A minus Bx. Then you can easily check that this is a solution of the algebraic equation found by this ABCD. Similarly, Y is also a solution. And this matrix A minus Bx is U here, and A minus Bi is V here, and they have the same eigenvalues, but the solutions are different. So this is the solution. This X is the solution of the algebraic equation, which is given by this matrix H for this U, where U is this one and V is this one, and they have the same eigenvalues, but the solutions are different. This is X and this is Y. It's not a one-one correspondence. Okay, okay, okay. Now, if you want to solve an algebraic equation, you have to start with that matrix H, which is called a linearizing matrix. But if you know that there could be many possible solutions, okay, you may have problem, okay, which one to choose. But somehow, if it guaranteed, if it is guaranteed that there is only one solution, then if somehow if you manage to find a solution, that is your answer. Okay, so you can go in a particular direction using some particular method. Okay, anyway, so one particular method for this is, I'll talk about it later, but just to give you a hint. So this is just like a polynomial function, you can say. Okay, but the variable is the matrix. Okay, but for any nonlinear equation, or suppose the variable is just scalar, you have Newton's method to solve it. So probably you can apply Newton's method to solve this one also. Considering this is a nonlinear function of x, which can be called as recursive operator or recursive function, because it is associated with the recursive equation. Okay, and you can apply Newton's method, for example. But if there is only one solution, the performance will be better for that method. So somehow you want to guarantee that there is only one solution, and then you can manage to find out that one, that's a unique solution. Okay, so but definitely the solution depends on the eigenvalues of H. Okay, as we already told you that solution x is there. Now eigenvalues of A minus Bx are nothing but the eigenvalues of H, and that A minus Bx depends on x. The solution depends on the eigenvalues of H indirectly. Okay, so on the spectral properties of H, if you somehow manage to classify some eigenvalues or some manipulation such that you can identify, okay, for this particular condition there is a unique solution, then you can propose a method to solve that particular solution. Okay, so in some applications there could exist different invariant subspaces associated with the same set of eigenvalues. Some additional properties are needed in order to select the subspace of interest, what kind of subspace you want. Okay, and this choice is generally made up relying on the spectral properties of the matrix H. Okay, so we now need to discuss the eigenvalue properties of the matrix H, because depending on that you can have a unique solution. Okay, now for that,
which eigenvalue are coming from?
Yes, you do not know that's the big deal. Eigenvalues of A minus XB are the same as eigenvalues of H. I mean, they are the eigenvalues of H as well. But you know only the eigenvalues of H, so you do not know which eigenvalue corresponds to the eigenvalues of A minus XB. But the last observation I said, eigenvalues of H, it is nothing but the union of eigenvalues of A minus Bx and that matrix. So then all the eigenvalues could be for some x eigenvalues of this or that. Yes. Yes. So we do not know. There are m plus n eigenvalues. So that's why it's an inverse problem. You do not know which eigenvalue belongs to which matrix. Yes, so you do not know that. So what is asking, that's very interesting question. So I said eigenvalues of this is nothing but the eigenvalues of what was that? A minus Bx union XB or XB, I think. Oh, CX. Oh, whatever. C. Okay. So you know the eigenvalues of this are the union of the eigenvalues of this or this, but you do not know which eigenvalue of this given the, because you know h, you can compute eigenvalues of h, let's say. So given those eigenvalues, you do not know which eigenvalue will belong to eigenvalues of this matrix and which eigenvalue will be eigenvalue of this matrix, that you don't know, and that's why this problem is difficult.
So if I choose
yes.
Now for particular, if I fixed lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n, then also the solution is may not be unique. Also, for choosing defined lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n, then also there may be
It will depend on the choice. That's true. Okay. So now we'll discuss something called splitting of a tuple of numbers. Okay, to understand the eigenvalue structure of this linearizing matrix H. So given a tuple lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda k, we are talking about this slide. So lambda 1, lambda 2 to lambda k, the set of complex numbers, but it is a tuple means it's ordered somehow. Okay, but forget about the ordering. Then we'll say that it has a k1, k2 splitting with respect to the imaginary axis, or C splitting. Okay, in some books you will just find it splitting. I am using the C because to mean that it is continuous, because continuous means that x dot t was equal to a x plus b, that's a continuous time invariant system. You can have the discretized version of that, and the stability region, like a matrix is a system is stable with all the eigenvalues of a in the negative half of the plane, that left hand side of the plane. But if you have a discrete system, that will not be the imaginary axis, but it will be the circle. So that's why everywhere I am using that letter C. C splitting, it's a continuous, C for the continuous, stands for continuous. Okay, so given lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda k, I'll have this as a k1, k2 splitting if we have this kind of a situation. This is the imaginary axis, we all know. And some of the eigenvalues are here, some of the eigenvalues are here, and some of them can be here. So suppose you consider this to be k1 and this to be, let's say, k2. You can have different kind of splitting actually. Okay, what does it mean? That this is a mathematical definition, so that's why you are saying permutation. Permutation means you know the eigenvalues, for example, lambda 2, lambda, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda k, but the first k1 need not be in a particular set, like the left hand side, or the first last k2 need not be in the right half of the plane, but they could be like first one, let's say lambda 1 is here in the left hand, lambda 2 here on the right hand side. So you need a proper permutation. So which one goes to which region? So let's say I have this example, if you don't understand, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4. Suppose this is here, but this is here, and this is again here, let's say, and this is here. So if I just say it is a k1, k2 splitting, then we have a problem. Okay. So this 1, 2, so first you take 1 and then 3 and then, first 1, then 4, then 2, then 3. So it's just a permutation of this. Basically, it says you have a splitting. Some are on the left hand side, some are on the right hand side, and some are on the axis. Okay. Yeah, so this notation C less equal to means the real part is less equal to 0. Left hand side of the plane, C bigger equal to means the real part of Z is bigger equal to 0. So depending on that splitting, we have three definitions. One is proper splitting, which means either of these two, either one of these two have no eigenvalue or no number lambda j, let's say, on the imaginary axis. So let's say if you want for this example, we can consider one which is like here, and the rest is like here. So k1 and k2. Okay. So proper splitting means omega 1 or w1 or w2 or omega 1 or omega 2 does not intersect the imaginary axis, or this is or. Strong splitting means both do not intersect the imaginary axis. That means all the eigenvalues are either on the right hand side or on the left hand side. A very strong splitting. And weak splitting means both intersect. Okay. So omega 1, there are some eigenvalues which are on the imaginary axis. In omega 2 as well, there are some eigenvalues on the imaginary axis. So you can always have a splitting. You can have more than one splitting given a couple of numbers, right? Lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda k. And this region is called a stability region, which you already know. Now I will define something called a stable subspace. Okay. So given a matrix and an invariant subspace of that matrix, we call it stable if it is spanned by Jordan chains associated with the stable eigenvalues. Okay. So what is this? So you have a matrix A. This is this. Now see interesting thing. This is nothing but AB equal to VJ. In fact, J is what? J is of this form. J on J2, let's say JK. So V, they consist of the Jordan chains corresponding to all these blocks, means all these corresponding eigenvalues. So you can write like a v1, v2, vk equal to some v1, v2, vk equal to some j1 dot 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 jk. So that means a v1 is nothing but v1 times j1, a v2 is nothing but v2 times j2, and so on. So each Jordan chain will give you actually an invariant subspace. This is an example of an invariant subspace, how you can create an invariant subspace. Okay, and if the diagonals are in eigenvalues here, if I'll say that the invariant subspace which is spanned by this Jordan chains stable, if the corresponding eigenvalues are stable, that means they are on the left hand side of the plane, strictly on the left hand side of the plane. Okay, I'll say the invariant subspace spanned by this Jordan chains is anti-stable if the corresponding eigenvalues are totally on the right hand side of the plane. Okay. Now an invariant subspace matrix called weakly stable, this is important, which I'll use little later, weakly stable if it is spanned by the Jordan chains associated with both stable and critical eigenvalues. So what is the critical eigenvalue? Which is on the imaginary axis. This is critical one. You do not know if this belongs to this one or this one. Okay. So this is called a critical eigenvalue. And similarly, a subspace called weakly anti-stable if it is spanned by Jordan chains associated with the anti-stable and critical eigenvalues. Okay. Then with all this, now we are ready to formalize the theorem which gives us uniqueness of the solution of the algebraic equation. So if the eigenvalues of H has a proper MNC splitting, this M and N is important. This M means K1, that N is K2, but M and N, they are also related to the dimension of that X, because X is of the type M cross N. Not only that, the spectra of H, I already told you, this is union of that, this was union of this, yes, union of this, A minus B X and this, and this is of order N cross N, so it will have N eigenvalues, and this will have order M cross M, which have M eigenvalues. So there is a M N splitting, okay, and if H has an invariant n dimensional C anti-stable graph invariant subspace, so what you know already is anti-stable invariant subspace from this definition. Okay, so the subspace which is spanned by the Jordan chains corresponding to anti-stable eigenvalues, so on the right hand side. Okay, so this n is the right hand side actually. So this n eigenvalues are there, which are on the right hand side, and if there is a graph invariant subspace which is C anti-stable, then the required equation has a unique solution such that this A minus Bx, this has all those n eigenvalues which are on anti-stable, the positive eigen, not the positive, but the positive or the right hand side of the plane. This MN splitting means N is on the right hand side, M is on the left hand side. If you see the definition here, K1, K2, K1 is on the left hand side, K2 is on the right hand side. Okay, so what is the proof of this? This is very simple. This is proof is obvious. Why? Because of this uniqueness follows from the fact that any invariant subspace of H, which is graph space, is associated with that equation H I n x equal to y n x a minus b x or x b or b x whatever it is, a minus b x. Okay, so it follows from that it is always unique, because you have an anti-stable graph invariant subspace which is spanned by the Jordan chains corresponding to the eigenvalues which are on the right hand side of the plane. You already have that, and you already know that there is a solution. Okay, because it has an n-dimensional subspace on this, so the solution must be equal to this. It follows from that it is one-one correspondence, that I n x, that graph space, and you already have an anti-stable graph invariant subspace. So they must be same. So this is unique. Oh, okay. I have only 5 minutes, so I'm a little late or slow. Okay. Now the question is: okay, suppose you have this unique thing, that you have this as unique. How do you compute it? You have to find this x. Okay. How do you find it? Now, as I said, you can apply Newton's method, for example, using let's say that argument that Ricciardi operation, Ricciardi function depending on x. But there you have one thing: the Jacobian of this function, Jacobian matrix of this function, should be invertible. We'll recall that fact for Newton's method. you see this F inverse, that derivative of that, something by that F derivative, okay, that derivative. So, Jacobian of that operator must be invertible, but here it is a matrix function. So, how do you define differentiability, how do you define Jacobian, okay. So, for that we have the concept of Frese derivative. So, that is what I am defining first, and then I will talk about the Jacobian corresponding to that Riccati operator. So, what is the Jacobian, the Frese derivative here? If you have any function defined on a norm linear space, so let us say you have this, okay, this is a norm linear space, this is a norm linear space. When do you say that it is differentiable? Like for R it is very simple, you know. So, otherwise what do you, how do you define this? This h goes to 0, you know, right, then I do not have to write, okay, x plus h minus f x, okay, minus h, what is this h? Hey, that is important, h should be equal to 0, this is w, this is v, norm on this. So, and this is a bounded linear operator, okay. So, I will say that f has a Frese derivative at x, if you perturb x, okay, then this can be approximated by a linear function operating on h, okay. So this is satisfied, then we call this is the Frese derivative of the function, has this is Frese differentiable, okay. So here the special interest is the norm linear space C into the, let us say, okay, it could be like m cross n as well, it is a matrix function, then I will say it is Frese differentiable if this is true, okay. The same thing I am writing here, just putting it here, that is it, this is small, and if it exists it is unique. So, you can read like this, the Frese derivative of f at x in the direction e, that is how you can, how we can read it. But if you want to know more about this, you must read the book of Hayam, Nick Hayam, so his book is Functions of Matrices, Theory and Computation, so you can read that, okay. Now, we consider the Riccati operator, which is this, this is matrix function Rx equal to C plus Rxa plus Dx minus Xbx, and you want to solve Rx equal to 0. So, you have to solve a non-linear equation, okay, the argument is a matrix, and the Frese derivative is given by this, it is very simple, you just compute this, whatever the remaining part that you defined as the linear operator, because it is linear on E. So, this is very easy to compute the Frese derivative of this Riccati operator, then this equation is actually equivalent to this, okay. So, what is this Wake and other things, okay. So, Wake means this, so if you have a matrix like this, X equal to this, x 1 1, okay, x 1 2, x 1 n, x 2 1, x 2 2, x 2 n, and so on, x a, let us a square matrix, or let us say this non square, does not matter, so let us a square x n 2, x n n, then the Wake operation of this is nothing but the vectorization of this matrix, which is stack all the columns one by one. So, start from this x 1 1, then x 2 1 dot 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 x n 1, then x 1 2 and dot 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 x n 2 and so on. So, last element should be x n n. So, it is now a vector which has a connection with this matrix, and how it is defined? You first take the first column, then take the second column and so on. So, stack all the columns one by one, it gives you a vector, which is called the vector, vectorization of this matrix, okay. Now, if you have this one, this matrix L x e, okay, if you take the Wake both sides, and this is a linear operator, this vectorization is a linear operator, means Wake of x plus y is and the Wake of x plus Wake of y, obvious. So, if you take this Wake of this and Wake of the right hand side, this will be nothing but this delta x Wake e, you have delta x of this form, and this O times, this times and then the circle is called a Kronecker product of two matrices. Now, what is that? So, given a matrix A and B, let us say this A is nothing but Aij and this B is anything, then this is nothing but this. So, this matrix B is getting multiplied with each entry of A, this is called the Kronecker product, and there is a very nice theorem which is easy to prove, that if you have this, this kind of a thing, then Wake of this is nothing but B transpose A times Wake of x. I just check if I am correct, I do not know, yeah, I think I am correct, okay. This is the thing, and now for if you apply Wake operation on this one, then what you do is Wake of script A x e, which is nothing but Wake of e a, means I e a, because you want to apply this theorem, minus d e, so you use Wake of d e i, identity matrix, of compatible size minus wake of IEBX, okay, this is one matrix, minus wake of IXBE. Now you apply this results on this. So, what do you get? On this, you will get first A transpose tensor product or the Kronecker product times I times wake of E, and here also you apply this and so on, and then you add it. Ultimately, you can end up with this one. That the wake of this ALX is nothing but delta x times wake E, the vector E, or delta x is of this particular form. And you will be surprised to know this is what is the Jacobian for this function. And this, what are the eigenvalues of this? This is just the Kronecker sum of two matrices, so this is a homework. Eigenvalues of this matrix is nothing but the eigenvalues of this plus the eigenvalues of this. Okay? So, when the Jacobian is, this is a Jacobian, when the Jacobian is singular, if this and xb minus d or this and xb minus d have a common eigenvalue, because suppose this and so this is d minus xb. Now, you just take the minus of this, so it will be xb minus d. Suppose that is lambda and this is some lambda. If they have a common eigenvalue, it means that minus times lambda is the eigenvalue of this. So, this will have eigenvalue 0, this will be singular. And what is that xp minus d? You go back. Xb minus d. So, I will come back to this one, that h, the eigenvalue of this was nothing but eigenvalue of a minus bx union eigenvalues of minus d plus xb. And if they have common eigenvalues, then the Jacobian will be singular. And then you stuck, you cannot apply Newton's method. So, first of all, you said eigenvalues of this is nothing but the eigenvalues of this union the eigenvalues of this, but they should not have any common eigenvalue. And see, I also talked about splitting. So, that means in the splitting of this eigenvalues of H, they cannot have a common eigenvalue, means they cannot have, let us say, an eigenvalue 0 or an eigenvalue which is common and which is lying on the imaginary axis. So, once you have an eigenvalue on the imaginary axis, let us say origin, just 0, then you are stuck. You cannot apply Newton's method, for example, because the solution will be singular, the Jacobian will be a singular matrix. The question is, how do you get rid of it? That means you want to maintain uniqueness, but you cannot apply the Newton's method, for example, and that is how those kind of solutions called critical method, critical solution. Now, the question is, H was there. Can you perturb this H a little bit so that you get a new matrix, solution is same, but the solution is not critical. Okay? So, from this H, you want to construct a new matrix H tilde, let us say, such that the solution will be same, that the invariant subspace will be same, but the solution will be non-critical for this matrix, which was critical for this. Yes. So can you do that? So, I will stop here. I am already running out of time. Okay. Thank you.
Second one, just an answer. Second one, 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 second one
necessary condition.
Necessary condition.
Then it follows.
But you have taken an example of this. You have constructed an example and you have shown that it is either this is X is a solution or this or not. Mm-hmm. You have checked for S, H. But it is a necessary condition.
First condition
is also
true.
If you want to check that this X is a solution of this required equation, we have to check this. For getting the X, there is a plenty of way.
How to find X? Interesting, lag raha
hai? Haan, what is that? Adhik research problem de liya. Pushing him to sir ki kya padh kar aaye.
Haan, ye bol de raha hai
aapko. Yehi present karenge.